You are on which chapter?
आई एम एक्चुअली टीचिंग प्योर सब्सटेंस.
ओके सर, सो
सो
कैन यू
इफ
ऑल्सो अटेंड इट ना इफ यू वॉन्ट टू सी
हाँ
रिवाइज.
यस यस यू कैन अटेंड. आई हैव ऑलरेडी स्टार्टेड, दैट मीन्स आई हैव टेकन टू लेक्चर्स, बट यस यू कैन एक्चुअली अटेंड. ओके. So in today's class, we are going to start with a new topic that is called refrigeration cycle. In this refrigeration cycle, unlike our power cycles, we have vapor as vapor and liquid. Alternatively, they are changing their phase, and it is its working fluid. So this is widely used, but there are also gas refrigeration cycles as well. Okay, keep in mind there are also gas refrigeration, pure means single phase refrigeration cycles are also there, whereas we have seen that for power cycles we do have both gas and vapor both. Okay, but we use vapor more widely. Here also we use vapor more widely. Okay, and the refrigeration cycle is somewhat opposite of how these power cycles work in some thermodynamic sense. We'll see. So this chapter basically includes the introduction to refrigeration cycle and its classification, idle vapor compression refrigeration cycle we'll talk about. Okay, this is also called vapor compression cycle. That was in the power cycle we call it vapor power cycle, right? Don't confuse with these keywords. Vapor power cycle is different and vapor compression cycle will be different. We'll be covering in this particular chapter. We'll also talk. Okay, I have missed the actual vapor power cycle in that part, so I will also cover this along with here also actual vapor compression cycles. What would be the difference with the actual with the ideal thing? We'll also discuss, not with details, maybe one or two slides. We'll look up some modified cases such as cascade refrigeration system, which is a modified refrigeration system over the conventional thing. And actually it adds your COP. It has certain characteristics so that its COP coefficient of performance increases. We'll also look some multi-stage compression refrigerant cycle, which would look similar to the cascade thing. This also has the capability of increasing COPs. At the end, we will talk about gas refrigeration cycle, unlike this vapor compression cycles. Okay, this is a bit opposite of what Brayton cycle was. Brayton power cycle, the opposite of Brayton power cycle, it would look like. Lastly, we will take up another non-conventional refrigeration system. There is another way you could achieve refrigeration, that is called absorption refrigeration cycle. We'll also look into this particular aspect. Okay, this is the whole overview of this particular refrigeration cycle we will take up. Okay, to start with refrigeration. Refrigeration is the transfer of heat from a lower temperature region to the higher temperature region. Okay, and this the concept of refrigeration, it dates back. Let's talk slight about the history of refrigeration. It dates back to 1834. Okay, English researcher or scientist called Jacob Perkins. He first patents this vapor compression refrigeration machine, closed cycle, ice machine. That I mean, those days they call it ice machine. Okay. And it dates back to 1834, so long. And after that, this undergoes very much vary of the modifications. Okay. Next thing, this device, the device that produces refrigerations are called refrigerators nowadays. Cycles on which they operate are called refrigeration cycles. Okay. And this refrigeration cycle has two classifications, namely vapor compression refrigeration cycle and gas refrigeration cycle. Vapor compression cycle is a cycle where vapor, why it is called vapor compression? Because when it is in vapor phase, vapor is compressed by the means of compressor. And then after few, certain stages through condenser and several other components, it undergoes phase changes. Vapor goes to phase change, to the liquid phase again, and then again vapor, and it makes a closed loop cycle. And yes, it works in that way, vapor compression cycle. Whereas gas refrigeration, you have certain, okay, this vapor is not of water vapor, it is basically of refrigerant, some sort of refrigerant. We'll talk a bit later what sort of, but there are some refrigerants that we use, such as liquid ammonia, or there are other things, some artificial refrigerants such as 134a or something. We used to take these things, okay, not water here, okay, just to keep in mind. So this vapor power cycle operates for working fluid as water and its vapor, but here you talk in terms of refrigerants, okay, not water here. Gas refrigerant is where the working fluid is a single phase refrigerant, single phase gas or refrigerant, but it does not undergo phase changes. But here it undergoes phase changes, and undergoing phase change would accompany a large heat transfer characteristics. Why? Because phase changes usually have large enthalpy of vaporization or enthalpy of fusion. Okay, so this H value is very large. That is why it is this phase change process is often accompanied with a refrigeration cycle because of the large heat transfer characteristics. This you should keep in mind. Okay, if may somebody ask that why refrigeration cycles are generally are associated with phase changes, phase change process during the whole process. So it is because of these things. Okay, it has large, the H value is very large. H value means the enthalpy of vaporization or enthalpy of fusion, or it will be larger. So just to summarize what we have done before, this thing we have already seen in second law manner. We have seen that you will have a cyclic process over here, some cycle, you will take some input. So while doing so, so this is the opposite of heat engine, right? Opposite of heat engine. So heat engine, what we do, from warm environment we take energy. We do some cyclic process. We take out some work and we leave some energy to the lower form of energy, right? This is opposite. We input some energy, some work energy, and we do some opposite cycle to what heat engine undergoes, and we take the heat from the already lower heated space to a warmer environment, right? This is the way this refrigerator works. And the refrigerator and heat pump usually differ the means of their aims. Basically, both the things are same. The both machines over here are same, but the only difference is your aim or your goal. So here, your in the refrigeration, your goal is to make things cool this side, and here in heat pump, your goal is to warm your other side. Okay. The only difference with the coefficient of performance of refrigeration is because of the desired thing. Your desired thing is different. Otherwise, required input is same. The cooling effect would be the desired thing for refrigeration, and heating effect would be the desired thing for heat pump.
Sir, the arrow should be opposite direction in left side.
No. It will be similar. So opposite will be the heat engine. Okay. It is doing basically the same thing, but the thing is, our refrigerator will be kept over here, and in cold countries you will be keeping yourself here. You will be sitting over here in order to use the same heat pump. So basically, whatever the machine that your refrigerator is having will be same machine will be sitting over here. Just your aim will be different. In hot countries, you need this side to be seated upon, or your food should be here. And in cold countries, you should be heated. You should be seated over this side. That's it. Okay. The arrow will be same. Right. Okay. To start with the idle. Ideal vapor compression cycle, we should also talk about why not Carnot cycle. I mean, again, we will ask the similar question what we asked in our power cycle. Also, why not Carnot cycle there? So we come up with something that whenever I choose my Carnot cycle inside this dome or outside this dome, okay, it is not feasible because of the turbine can't work substances, because it has to operate at particular substance phase. Okay. And there are other things also, but we restricted ourselves that, okay, Carnot cycle is not the practical cycle. Here also, we can think of a reverse Carnot cycle as my refrigeration cycle. Reverse, I mean, there it was 1, 2, 3, 4, something like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, something like this. Here, we'll go opposite 1, 2, 3, and 4. And we expect it to be, things to be cooled over here in this place. I mean, the heat would be taken away by this particular process forward to two. Everything seems to be for me to be fine from 1 to 2 and 3 to 4, because you may work with constant pressure heat addition and constant pressure heat rejection processes by condenser and evaporator. But the problem arises when you talk about 2 to 3, when you compress your thing, your refrigerators, from 2 to 3, basically it undergoes from saturated mixture to saturated vapor. Okay, so your compressor has to work with multiphase again, and that is not a physical practical solution. Compressor cannot do both the things. Either you should use pump, okay, if you have liquid, either you should pump it to increase the pressure, or if you have vapor, you should compress it. So you cannot use compressor for both the things. Okay, so this is not a feasible solution. Although we can take up this turbine over here, and this could be asymptotic. And this also, you see that there is some loss of quality of the steam, or sorry, loss of not quality, but, oh, I'm sorry. So this can be achieved. This can be achieved actually, because there is no steam, quality of steam we will talk about here. But as a turbine, you can actually achieve it, but the problem is with compressor over here. So the compressor is one problem, and another problem, if at all we are using turbine, ideally for Carnot cycle, putting turbine would be a huge cost, and it seems unworthy if your home is with a noise such as if your turbine is working, you cannot be sitting at your home comfortably. Okay, that's for sure. So you don't want turbines to be operating at your home. Okay, so another alternative people have thought of is from going from 4 to 1 is you can replace it with isoenthalpic or throttling devices, something called throttling devices. Throttling devices, such as your capillary tube. You can see your capillary tubes that are there in your refrigerators. Capillary tubes are there, porous tubes. Okay, you'll see why it is called throttling devices, and it has constant enthalpic process. This accompanies constant enthalpy process, constant H process, rather than constant S process, which turbine undergoes. Okay, so this is the two difference. These things limit our things to use reverse Carnot cycle. So we equipped with something called, we come up with ideal vapor compression refrigeration cycle, and this is widely used at our homes. Okay, in this cycle, we have 1 to 2, we have isentropic compression in a compressor. So from 1, state 1, to 2, there is a device called compressor. And, okay, let me draw the TS diagram for that. So T and S diagram for this. So we will have a vapor dome over here. Similar vapor dome for refrigerants also, similar to the steam. So we start with somewhere here. This is my one. We start with saturated vapor. Okay, and this is desirable also. So low pressure, low temperature, saturated vapor state of your refrigerants will be okay. You will start with saturated, and that is advantageous also for this compressor to compress things. It is an isentropic compression, it goes straight 1-2 somewhere to, I don't know, somewhere to, and 2 will be your high pressure, high temperature, and superheated vapor phase. Okay, somewhere here, and you also have those lines. What lines? These lines are there, constant pressure lines, right? Okay. So from 1 to 2 you go from here to here. Now you pass it through condenser. Condenser is a device which you will actively study in your heat transfer course, and this condenser and evaporator are essentially your heat exchangers. Okay, essentially it exchanges heat by some means, and you are going to coil up two pipes on one to each other, and will try to extract heat from one to other. So it will take away, it will liberate some heat in terms of QH, and it comes from 2 to 3, and this is a constant pressure process. and you reach over three this place. Okay, you are still at high pressure. Now this 3 to 4 is a very unique thing that is very unique to this particular vapor compression cycle, and this is called expansion valve. So I'm not going to take up this thing very in detail, but you should know that just by going 3 to 4 is an isoenthalpic process, or throttling process. In throttling process, your pressure decreases drastically. Pressure decreases drastically. So P4 is much less than P3, and due to this pressure decrement, you will lose your temperature drastically as well. Temperature drastically. So you go from 3 to 4, but you don't know whether your entropy is kept constant by expansion valve or not. It is not. So you go some, not by straight down, you go somewhere here, you increase, you have the increment of entropy as well. So 3 to 4 you come up over somewhere here, and then 4 again constant pressure process. This is again a evaporator, similar heat exchanger over here, and it takes up heat from some environment in order to go from mixed state to again the saturated vapor condition, and it makes a cycle. So this is a complete cycle, refrigeration cycle, you would expect, and this is somewhat opposite to what we have seen in our vapor compression cycle. How different? So we pump things, we go from here to here to here, and then we come down through turbine and we come here. So we go essentially in the opposite direction, somewhat opposite direction to what these power cycles usually does. Okay, and in order to do this, we actually have it has taken QL amount of heat from this particular space over here, and this space is what our aim was to make things cool. Okay, so basically this particular cycle is sitting here. Okay, this is what is sitting over here. It's taking up heat, taking up some compressor work. Okay, I've missed that. So during this particular process, it takes W in, some work W in. Okay, so actually this cycle is sitting in this second law analysis. It is sitting over here. It takes up things, goes in this manner. Okay, this is the similar plot what I have, schematic of TS diagram for ideal vapor compression cycle. This is a similar plot I have taken. So one thing I want you guys to notice that, so what is my, how much amount of QL you would have? QL would be this much, right? How did I decide my QL? This, because my Q, I know that it is TDS. Okay, from 4 to 1. Okay, so this is your QL. What if I would have chosen my things to be operated with turbine? So it should go somewhere from 3 to 4 dash, not 4. Okay, if I would have chosen, turbine as my expanding device, 3 to 4. We can very well do that, and we'll see that you will have, this time you will have more, this much more amount of QL you will get. Basically, your efficiency, your COP, now QL by W in is, let's suppose, constant, so QL is larger, so you'll have larger COP, if you choose turbine. So you can very well do that, but this is not a feasible solution because you don't want turbines to be operating nearby you. Okay. So that is why it was a feasible solution, although you are losing some of the performance, but this thing was a great solution by throttling process. And this throttling process is essentially works on something called Joule-Thomson effect. Should I take things in detail or you guys will read this? I would strongly suggest you guys should read that. Why going from 3 to 4, the temperature decreases and the pressure decreases. As the pressure decreases, temperature decreases. Although it is intuitive, but it actually, by idle gas law, it is intuitive. If pressure is decreasing, your temperature will also decrease. Okay, as you would notice that if you go uphill on a mountain, your pressure, you lose pressure, your molecules are rare, you lose pressure and you see that temperature also decreases. But here, this works basically in a pipe, it is happening, and this is not actually idle gas, it should not follow, but it follows another phenomena called Joule-Thomson effect. And I would strongly suggest you guys to read, but we don't want to emphasize more on this. I want you guys to read this thing, okay, Joule-Thomson effect. And if you are interested, I can actually take things up, but not in some later chapters, but not now. Okay, so this is your typical refrigerator that should look like. So let's suppose you can notice a black box, a sort of elliptical box that is kept down behind the refrigerator. It is called compressor. So it actually compresses your refrigerant in superheated space. This is your once the compressor is working, it undergoes superheated phase with this orange line. Okay, it goes through condenser units. You can see it in your refrigerators. Okay, which creates heat QH. Okay, then it undergoes something called throttling process, and this throttling process decreases the pressure and decreases the temperature. And this is basically a capillary tube. You will see very, very nice capillary tube will be there, very thin pipe. I mean, this condenser pipe would have a larger diameter, and this capillary tube have very thin diameter. Okay, you'll see. I mean, today you guys should go and just see these things. You will actually find these things in your home. Okay, you'll see very thin wire that is going across, and which is coiled somewhere, something like this. And this is essentially an isenthalpic process. The enthalpy remains constant, and yes, after this it undergoes evaporator coil, and this evaporator coil is basically taking things up for your things to be cooled inside. Okay, similar plot on TS can also be equivalently shown in the form of pressure and enthalpy plot as well. The vapor domes look something like inverted here. Okay, and we start from 1 here. We go to 1 to 2, enthalpy increases, pressure increases. From 2 to 3, 2 to 3 is a basically constant pressure process. So this is constant pressure. This is happening at constant pressure. Now it comes down. Why down? Because it is an isenthalpic process. H3 is equal to H4. Okay, just comes down in this particular plot, but here it doesn't come down. The entropy slightly increases. Okay, and now 4 to 1 is again constant pressure process, which is lesser than the condenser pressure. This is the evaporator pressure, and this is constant. And this goes similarly. So these two plots are very much similar to each other. Here, just one advantage is we could get the information of H1, H2. H3 and H4 very quickly, okay. Whereas here you have to seek things. Now let's come to Okay, we don't have much time, so we have already have 45, so I don't want to take things. So we'll take up these things in tomorrow's class. Okay. Similar things will be happening. I mean, we'll devise some COPs based on our QL, and QL is nothing but H1 minus H4. What we have seen so far in every devices. Okay. So let's conclude this class. And so far, any doubt? Anybody? No, yes?
No.
Okay. So I'll take attendance. I'll stop recording.